Okay, so very good evening. We want to welcome everyone on behalf of the National Thyssen-Bornemisza Museum and TBA21 to this presentation of the Stephanie Comilang exhibition In Search of Life, which we're opening today. And we're opening it with this dialogue between the artist herself and Chus Martínez, who's the curator of the exhibition. I'm going to briefly introduce Stephanie. Stephanie is a Canadian artist and filmmaker, Filipino ancestry, who lives between Toronto and Berlin, and she has presented her films in innumerable institutions, which I'm not going to go through because it's an endless list. But in any case, amongst her latest projects, maybe the best known, because it's recent and because it was widely discussed, is her exhibition on an installation which was called Pina, which was presented in Berlin at the Julia Deutsche Foundation and later in TBW Toronto. And with Stephanie in the foundation, we've already worked on some projects, mainly one during the pandemic, which we discussed this morning. And out of that project, we really wanted to keep working with her. And that's how this exhibition came about, which is an exhibition which we co-curated or co-produced with the Aisha Foundation, because it's a project which is a diptych. And so the first episode of this diptych is being presented here now. And the second episode will be presented next year in February in the context of the Savvy Biennale. And I'm sure that Chus is going to tell you a lot more than I, so I don't want to take up any more of your time. Just to say that the exhibition is accompanied by some very rich public programs with an important film series, which we're hosting in partnership with Casa Asia, which is one of our partners in this project. And we also have the help and the sponsorship and the support of the Embassy of Canada in Spain and the German Embassy in Spain. And we'd like to give a very warm welcome also to the Embassy of the Philippines in Spain. We know that you're here and that you've been a great support for the project and publicized it a great deal. So thank you very much. And I'm going to leave you with Chus Martínez. I haven't introduced her, but I think most of you know her already. She is the director of the Institute of Art, Gender and Nature of the School of Art and Design of Basel. And she is the associate curator at TBA21. So thank you for everyone, and both of you especially. Thank you very much, everyone, for being here today and joining us in this very special day in which we're presenting this great work, this great installation. I'm going to give a quick introduction in Spanish and then I'll switch to English. I hope that that's going to be okay for everyone. If you have any problems, please say so and somebody will get you some headphones so that you can follow the translation. As I was saying, this is a great installation. You'll watch two films, but you're actually just watching one, and you'll see some textile works, which are also part of the same piece, which is one, which is a work which brings together the migration of monarch butterflies with human migration. It's a work which thinks very interestingly about the memory of migration in general and about the impact that the past has upon the present, on forms in the present, roots in the present, and also on the perception of other communities within ours in the contemporary present.
I'm gonna switch to English, otherwise you will not understand. And actually we do these talks to have a little introduction before you go into the work. The work in itself is so understandable that you would not need any introduction. It's a way of finding a conversation and a dialogue that you may continue with your friends and at home. I must say that this work and working with Stephanie gave me a pedagogical restitutional moment. Me, like many other people of my generation in Spain, we know about the colonial relationship in between Spain and the Philippines, but we know nothing else. We only know that they name it at school, but we don't have any form. We have no idea of the facts, and actually we have almost no idea of the consequences, consequences in the past and consequences in the present. So it has been an enormous honor to actually dig into that story, start reading, and actually accompany her in that journey that made possible an incredible work that is also constituted in a way that is not there to create any form of guilt, but a form of restitution that is not based in the restitution of objects, but I would say the restitution of the dignity and the possibility of looking at each other's eyes in the same terms, and being able to actually acknowledge the many layers that we don't see and we don't experience in everyday life, because we are perhaps a little bit far away from experience of other people, but we actually need to find ways of taking them in, of remembering them and finding for them an experience and a memory in our heads that would allow us to feel not only empathy, but to understand that the social constitution of the future needs actually another very sophisticated, if you excuse me, very complex but necessary form of coexistence. So without more, I would just ask Stephanie, I think, how did you came to the idea actually to do this piece and to introduce, let's say, the non-human and the migration of the butterflies into that human migration and human testimony of the Filipino seafarers in the piece?
The idea of the butterfly happened actually because of a dream that my husband had. And before that, I wasn't really thinking about the butterfly. So my husband woke up one day and he said, I had a dream that you were having an exhibition. And they were of paintings. I'm not a painter. And he was like, there were these large-scale paintings, very gestural and expressionist and lots of colors. They were also stretched really badly, he said, so they were falling off of the stretcher, and like everyone's freaking out, and it was super chaotic at the exhibition. But he said that the ideas for the paintings were that they were painted by butterflies. And so this idea of like the perspective of the butterfly was something that I started thinking about. And in, you know, further research, I started thinking about the monarch butterfly, who is one of the longest migrating animals and insects in the world. In the UK, they travel from the north of UK to sub-Saharan Africa, which is 18,000 kilometers. And in North America, they travel from Canada to Mexico. So if you can imagine that flight, how long that is, and one small insect is traveling so far, it really captures your imagination, and you think about how they're able to fly, why they fly. So this, along with the butterfly's metamorphosis and those ideas around that, is something that really caught my attention. I mean, this is something that, as humans, it's something that we've latched onto forever. You know, you hear it, it's in literature, it's in art, it's not something new. But for me, the ideas around migration is what really, you know, brought ideas together. You know, my work usually deals with ideas of home and what that means, how that changes for migrants, for refugees, for people that move around the world. So it felt like a natural fit for me.
Whoop. That's a performance. I remember when we first started talking that you were mentioning an episode during COVID of the Filipino fleets being stopped outside harbors, mm-hmm. and not being able to go outside because of people fearing them, contagious mm-hmm. illnesses. and so on. And I thought it was a very powerful image of 750, if I don't remember badly, 750,000 seafarers, Filipino seafarers, being kind of stopped outside the harbors and not being able to actually go home just because of the fear of people that these people would have COVID or something else and being contagious. Perhaps you can talk about how you became very interested in the Filipino seafarers and what do they mean to you in the work?
Yeah, so TBA21 during the pandemic commissioned me, you guys, to make a video for Ocean Archive, which is their online program dedicated to everything TBA. And so during that time, I was thinking about and reading a lot about the news and how there were seafarers, many of them Filipinos, who were stuck on ships. 25% of the world's labor population are from the Philippines. So a lot of these Filipinos were stuck on ships. And I started thinking about how, you know, a lot of them were stuck in their home ports, but they weren't able to return home. And so that was something that really stayed with me. You know, what does it mean to see your home in front of you, but you're not able to return to it? And so I made a short film called Diaspora Ad Astra, which is based on a book of short stories that I found in the Philippines with the same name. And they're science fiction short stories made by young adults. And one of the stories was an astronaut who was stuck on a ship and couldn't return home. So, and a lot of my work has, I work with like within genres. So I tend to like stack genres. So I call my work or my films science fiction documentary. And I know these two genres are quite far apart, but I like putting them together because I think it's hard to do documentary itself. I think you need a rounder idea, more perspectives, layered perspectives. So Diaspora Ad Astra, which was actually, so it's told from the perspective of a seafarer who's stuck on a ship, can't return home, and is reading this book, Diaspora Ad Astra. And it's scenes of shots that I'd, you know, shot of the Philippines from a drone, of the sea, voiced by my dad, actually. My parents actually factor into my films a lot through voice. Yeah, so that's sort of the origin story for this larger project, Search for Life.
You will see it in the film, but the butterflies and the Filipino seafarers, somehow they coincide in a particular space, which is a space of Nueva España, today Mexico. So the butterflies, they migrate from the north of Canada to Mexico. It was only discovered in 1975 that they were spending the winter there. Before that time, it was kind of suspect that they were hibernating somewhere, but it was not clear where. And when you read the reports of the scientists saying and talking about how they discovered it, they talk about a cloud of thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of butterflies in front of their eyes as a sort of revelation and a miracle that would actually give body to a possibility that they thought it existed in their minds, which is the species would actually die and be reborn, maintaining the goal of the trip of migrating and surviving. Surviving is definitely also something that is at the core of this piece. And then the Manila ships, like the galleons, as they call it, they were going from Manila to Nueva España. And then the Spaniards, if you read, I said it today in the press conference, if you read the history books, actually they say that the route was also discovered. And I say discover because it's really interesting how the use of language made us believe that it happened in a point of time. The butterflies were in Mexico as long as they exist, but they were discovered in 1975, of course, by the humans. The roots were always there, but they were discovered in 1565 by two seafarers from the Basque country. Miguel León de Legazpi and Andrés de Urgabandi. So these two people are the ones that discovered the route that made it possible for the Spaniards to sail in between Manila and Acapulco and back. But the back part is the difficult part. And actually, who knew about the possibility of modifying the route to survive were the Filipino seafarers. So the Filipino seafarers were seafarers that for centuries were sailing between all the islands that constitute the Philippines. And not only that, they were safely exchanging information about all the routes, commercial routes, that they were defining the relationship in between China and the Philippines. This knowledge passed for centuries, generation after generation, was then kind of taken by the Spaniards that forced those people to work in the construction of the cargo ships. Like today, the cargo ships have another form, but it's also so interesting that by that time, the Spaniards and the Portuguese, they were talking about the possibility of constructing a 20,000-ton cargo ships that they were sailing twice a year in between Manila and Acapulco and back, having all the goods going from Manila, like the Manila sole and many other things that were actually coming from China, and getting back to the Philippines with the silver coins. So those that make that possibility for the Spanish Empire, I would say for two empires to connect, the Chinese and the Spanish Empire, one through the commercial good and the other one through the distribution of those goods in Europe, were the Filipino seafarers. And those descendants of these skills and knowledge are the ones talking in the video. Mm-hmm. And how did you meet them?
So there's two Filipino seafarers that you meet in the film. One of them is a seafarer turned painter named Jor Songquia. And he was introduced to me because a friend of mine was at the same artist residency in the Philippines. He lives in the Philippines, in La Union, by the water. I met him through this friend who knew that I was doing this project. And we started talking, initially just through Zoom. And you see him in the film. He has this really beautiful, articulate way of speaking about his mother, speaking about the ocean, speaking about life on ship, and speaking about painting, his process. And when we first started speaking through Zoom, I told him about the project and that I was interested about in incorporating ideas of butterflies, and he got it right away. But another thing was also that he told me that he had seen butterflies on the ships already, and this was really odd and strange because the ships were so far out to sea that, yeah, it was almost like an apparition to see a butterfly. And in Filipino culture, you know, there's lots of superstition around butterflies. You know, they're your ancestors, or they're you know, your family, your ancestors who have died. So he started thinking about that, and I started thinking about that. And so there's a moment in the film where he's painting this picture of this veiled figure with butterflies, and actually I had asked him to paint that. So it was a narrative that I had sort of got from his stories of butterflies, but then also from my thinking of how to incorporate, you know, this sort of fictional element into the story. But it wasn't really far off from the truth. You know, he kept kind of slipping back into like truth and fiction while we were filming. So that was, yeah, that was super interesting and almost a coincidence, his seeing the butterflies on the ship.
And what was the most difficult part of the film? I think the film unites, has a voice of a boy in Michoacán, which is the place where the butterflies migrate. It has the voice of an historian that tells us about the galleons de Manila. It has a voice of a scientist that tells us about the migration of the butterflies. It has the voice of the butterflies. Mm-hmm. So how did you came, like how did you construct the film and what were you after?
Usually when I make a film, I'll spend a lot of time going to the place and listening and talking to the people that I'm interviewing. So I made this film called Come to Me Paradise, which is a science fiction documentary about Filipino domestic workers in Hong Kong. And for that, I spent about a month just kind of looking and trying to get a rounder idea of what it was like there. So the process is usually speaking first and listening before actually doing anything. I also don't really write a script beforehand. I'll just go and listen and then kind of come back and think. For this, I filmed in the Philippines and then I filmed in Mexico. And then I came back and kind of constructed dialogue and a script based on what I heard. So I came back and thought of, I was watching the interviews a lot and started coming up with things and thinking about things. I had certain things that I wanted to shoot with already in Mexico and the Philippines. But yeah, it wasn't, it actually, I constructed it more in the editing process. And with that, I knew that I wanted a voice, which I usually use, a fictional voice. This time, I used my own voice. So the voice that you hear, the voice of the butterflies is my voice. But you hear the voice in different languages. So I did this by, with this program that trains on your voice and learns it and then can then speak different languages. So the languages that you hear in the film are Mandarin, Tagalog, and Spanish. And that made it actually a lot easier for me to construct a narrative, to work with my own voice, to work with different languages. Yeah, that was the process. I knew the overall narrator, I wanted that narrator to kind of, you know, navigate the whole film.
And you said it at the beginning that you are not doing a documentary, and this is not a documentary, but there is moments of, let's say, testimonial, incredible testimonial power. So the camera is asking and people respond and mm-hmm. you are recording it. But then the way that these things, these testimonial moments are waved into other narratives like the voice of the butterflies, and also with some use of post-production to kind of make the ship visible. So the seafarers in the movie, they are not in the ship anymore. They're mm-hmm. out the ship, but the ship is there, as it is there in a memory of your head when you think about it. So it's almost like a phantom present. So mm-hmm. why do you think that this way of working is actually more fertile than just revealing, let's say, the situation and the conditions of so many millions of people in the diaspora?
Yeah, I tend to not actually, when I'm thinking a lot about like labor and talking about migrant labor, I don't show the actual labor because I don't think it needs to be necessarily shown. We know how difficult it is. You just, you know, go on Google or pick up a newspaper and you can read about it and you can read about the conditions. So in a way, for me, it's not important to show that. It's important to speak to them. You know, in the film, you never see them on the ship. And yeah, it wasn't, in a way, you know, it's not that important for me to show this labor. Same with Come to Me Paradise about the Filipino migrants in Hong Kong. I never showed them at work. You know, it's not the story that I wanted to tell. Instead, the story was a story about how they spend their own time, how they spend their leisure time, what do they do on their days off, how do they create community. And this was something that I wanted to focus on more. You know, Joar and his painting, or the seafarer turned florist. You know, this, you know, in a way it was like, you know, these men were able to move into a different thing, were able to sort of transform. They had the ability to move away from being a seafarer.
What are the superstitions about the butterflies in Philippines? I'm curious.
Well, Joar kind of mentioned it a little bit, you know, because I think he told me the story of the butterflies, and he also ended up relaying that information to his mother, and his mother was right away like, oh, that's your grandmother, for sure. It already went to, like, you know, someone. That's your sister. That's someone.
No, it's so interesting because when you start working on it, then of course, I knew, but you rediscover the fact that the Manila swirl is actually like a piece of embroidery on silk produced in Guangzhou, which is Canton in China. And it has been actually highly distributed, but it was so successful, as you may know, in Spain that it constituted part of our identity, at least in the south, in our traditional ways of understanding ourselves as Spaniards and flamenco and the south culture. Mm-hmm. And it comes from China. So I thought it's absolutely amazing to be a little bit Chinese, a little bit from Manila, a little mm-hmm. bit of that root, and carry and embody it, knowing or not knowing it. But also the butterflies are super powerful. I start reading, and apparently in China, they are an incredible myth, as you are saying, of embodying the possibility of reincarnation, or let's say a life that may take many forms and never ends, like the life of the butterfly, because it possesses a memory of a previous life. Mm-hmm. And that memory is actually proof. It's so interesting that something that starts like a poetic and ancient wisdom is actually proof that they do have a memory that carries on the root and the goal of their lives. As you may perhaps carry on the duties of the grandmother and may kind of come as a reminder that you need to do something. So I thought that it's so interesting that you actually use those animals in the embroideries, mm-hmm. and that those embroideries now kind of unite in a really interesting way the knowledge carried by the animals into the society. We always talk about how much societies can do for nature. We always try to produce nature from the point of view of us humans and the societies we build, but we never thought about learning from the butterflies and actually taking some of their traits into account for our own mythologies and future ones, not only past ones. So I thought that was really interesting in the work. And I'm curious about how are you conceiving or thinking about the second part of the work?
No, don't ask me that.
Doesn't matter because...
I'm showing
you
the
can
work.
Invent it.
Yeah. I mean, the butterfly as a character, it will still be in the second part. I know that. The work will have a second life in Sharjah for the Sharjah Biennale in 2025. And because I'm showing the work there, it will be specific to there. So I need to go there and see things. It was a main port, so there's lots of movement and people that have gone through that port. So, I mean, port cities are extremely interesting just because they contain so much history and mixture of people and things, like Manila. So I'm excited to go there and see what I can find.
And... I think, I don't know how can you say that, but piña has been a very present element. You know, piña is the fabric on which the butterflies are embroidered in the exhibition, and it's actually a fabric that is made with the
fiber, the top of the pineapple, so the leaves, so the very thick leaves that are almost like cacti, you know, they're pounded and then woven. And the material is fine, but also durable and also transparent. So it's this, now it's in the Philippines, you know, it's the traditional barong, which is like what the men wear, and then also the women wear dresses with like the butterfly sleeves. And then there's also, you know, it's ubiquitous, you see it everywhere, you know, but the material is really difficult to make. It's like hand woven, you know, so it's quite expensive to buy. It's very, very, very beautiful. Yeah. And so the pineapple, you know, this is something that I had thought about in a previous work called Piña, Why is the Sky Blue? That I made with my partner and husband. We were thinking through ideas again around colonial trade between Ecuador, the similarities between Ecuador and the Philippines, visiting each other's countries, we realized that there were so many similarities there, and we were thinking of how to a symbol, you know, a symbol that could unite the two places. And so the pineapple came about. The pineapple, of course, is from Brazil, traveled across the ocean to Europe, which in Europe was extremely coveted and a luxurious product. You know, dinner parties, they just passed it around. They never ate it because it was such a commodity. And then it ended up in the Philippines. And in the Philippines, it became such a Filipino thing, you know. And there are so many things that do this, you know. If you think about the pineapple in Hawaii or, you know, the sugar cane in the Caribbean, there are so many histories within one thing, and it's just, you kind of just have to choose it, and then there's just a multitude of things that you can listen to and hear from one thing. So that's what I'm interested in, you know.
Because you kind of insist in elements that constitute a reflection on, I would not call it post-colonial because I don't think we are in any post-colonial time, but the colonial continuation and, let's say, morphing of the colonial extractionism in many ways and recuperating elements, connecting those elements that are natural with cultural all the time, which I think is so interesting because it's not only a history of culture as hand or human-made, but also nature has been involved repeatedly into that history, and you are kind of making these elements and coming back to them, like diaspora is such a powerful theme and powerful element of your work. Like, are you seeing, like, do you have some sort of script or, let's say, a vocabulary or a glossary of those elements that obsess you or you are curious about, and then you go through them in a systematic way, or they come in a more intuitive way to you?
I think it's more of a voice rather than like a vocabulary. I think it's like a fictional voice, but it's a voice that like all of the people that I've spoken to throughout my career, which my career has a lot to, and is focused on ideas around home. These voices are voices that I'm always listening to and paying attention to and bringing that into the next work, whether it's through ideas around, you know, or the pineapple or the butterfly or seafarers or spirit houses or, you know, types of architecture. These are the things that, and the voices that are always there, you know, it's a constant. And for me, these are really easy to pull from. I guess it's a vocabulary, but it's more of like a entity or something, I think. It's more of like a voice somewhere.
And because of that, perhaps, for me it's interesting to ask, is there any desirable effect? I don't know how to actually frame that question. It's not effect, the word, but it's some sort of a... Do you think that the work, not only the one that we are seeing here, but the totality of the work is creating conditions for a way of feeling and talking about those processes that you are contributing to, which is specifically yours and very important to you?
I mean, I'm interested in how this work will land here. Just like you say, it's... like, for instance, you know, I mean, I've been telling the story, but I had, like, people tell me to go to the Palacio de Cristal here in Madrid, which is, like, a very famous tourist spot. It's a very beautiful building made of glass, and it's in the Retiro Park. And these friends didn't really mention, you know, the history or the background, but in doing my own research, which was easy to do, I realized that it was built for the exposition of the Philippines in the 1880s. And so this project was completely racist and violent, and that kind of thing isn't taught here in Spain, I don't think. It doesn't seem like it's common knowledge, and I find that really problematic and upsetting, and I wonder why that is.
Because we are both terrible at doing it and terrified by doing it. I remember when I was a migrant worker in New York working at Museo del Barrio, that everyone around me, coming from the Caribbean, they call me the colonizer. It was some sort of a joke, if you want. And I, all the time, I was on denial, and I was saying, no, no, I'm not, because... And then I gave all terrible explanations and excuses. I said, no, no, I'm not, because I come from Galicia, and it's a poor region of the country, and actually no seafarers went into the ship, so obviously, then I could not be an ancestor of the colonizer. No, I'm not a colonizer, because they went so many centuries ago, and we are not actually, we don't do it anymore, and actually we are in terrible economic shit, so we are really not colonizing anybody, you know. Every explanation was worse than the next. Till one day, after talking to myself so many hours and having so many confrontations with the communities, not only one, but many, communities that came from the Caribbean, communities that came from Central America, communities also from South America, they were also migrants in the United States, and all of them, unanimously calling me the colonizer, I said, I am. I am the colonizer. And I am the colonizer. We are the colonizers because we carry the memory of it. Because actually, it is not a question of the individuum. It's really a question of a substance that we carry on historically. We embody it in a certain way. And it's actually better to take responsibility for that memory and for what we did in a, let's say, fertile way, not only apologizing, but by doing so, also going to all possible elements, as you are doing in your work, to find ways of restitution of connectivity. Because, of course, one of the outcomes of this has been a relationship in between the countries and the communities and the people. And you don't want to erase it, or actually, but you don't want to actually carry on with the damage. And it's so complex. And particularly here, we have not been good at all because we did not find the language, and we should also be able to say we need to. We need to find the language, and we need to carry that pain. And it's fine to carry it and to say we are the colonizers, even today, and find a way through the future. And I think that works like yours actually is finding a way of going into the exhibition space and finding a joy in encountering the other. And that's absolutely, at least, a very hopeful beginning to a relationship marked by a little bit of fairness, if this is possible to name. So perhaps we can give you the opportunity of posing some questions. We are about to close that hour, and I think the most important thing now is to see the work. And I would like to remind you that we make a little bit of an effort to invite two amazing people to write about the exhibition, Feifei Zhu and Mara Coson. Feifei is a Chinese architect, an expert in wildlife, that is actually analyzing the impact of wildlife in the construction of societies and cities. And Mara Coson, which is one of the most amazing writers of the Philippines today. And the booklet is online and it's so easy to download for free, and you can read about the work under a complete different perspective. And Mara and Feifei are coming live, and we are gonna have a conversation with them and Stephanie, so please check it to follow up with this. And Marianne Pastor Roces, one of the most amazing intellectuals of the Philippines, is also coming. And we also have a film program, thanks to the collaboration with Casa Asia and the advice of Ryan Martin. Sorry about the lapsus. So I think that there is plenty of opportunities to enter and to discover and to learn and to reconsider and to reinterpret ourselves, I mean. So please, questions before the alcohol and the work.
Good afternoon, everybody. I just want to congratulate you for all your work and for your magical imagination.
Thank you.
It was lovely to hear you. And I feel so surprised of all the things that you do and everything that you were like planning and not planning, because it's like you said, these ideas are these voices in my head, you know? Mm-hmm. All the inspirations you got from all the people around, from your ancestors even, right? So I would like to congratulate you for that. And I would like to congratulate you too, because you are amazing. I mean, this way of thinking about the colonizers is unbelievable. Just, I don't want to ask anything because I'm surprised. I'm just in awe, in absolute. But just wanted to say that.
Thank you so much.
I actually have a question about the color of the butterfly, because you were talking about the matriarchal butterfly that is orange. Mm-hmm. But then what about the different colors? Because, for example, when my grandmother died, and this is a true story, we have a house in the mountains and we have a river, and then the whole river started to be full of white butterflies. But like, it's incredible, it's full of them from one month to the other one. So I was thinking about that, but also what does it mean when it's orange, when it's white? It depends on the trajectory. How do you map it through color? I don't know anything about this, so maybe you know more. And thank you, by the way.
Thank you. I'm not a butterfly specialist, but I know that the monarch butterflies, according to the butterfly specialist that I spoke to, are orange, he says, because of opossumatism, which is a way to detract their predators away from them. So the predators see the color and know that they shouldn't eat it because it's poisonous. So I think it's a way, it's a self-preservation tactic, I know, for monarch butterflies. I don't know about the butterflies that are white.
I read about it.
Chus knows.
So what happens is that those that are really successful in migration, they get the spots of white bigger and bigger. They don't know why, but apparently it carries an information about the success. It's as if you are like in the high sport club, and then those that really manage the best performance get a bigger white spot. So they really think like the pigment change. So those that they succeed in less dying generations, the colors that they come with are whiter and whiter. And it's so interesting because it contrasts with the question of the fear of the orange thing. I really recommend to read on butterflies. It's a fantastic thing. But yeah, I did not understand why.
Anyone else? There's one there in the back.
There is a question there.
Good evening. Thank you very much to both our important personalities on the stage for this very interesting conversation. I'm Mark Kamoy. I'm the deputy head of mission of the Embassy of the Philippines here in Madrid. And before coming to Spain for this tour of duty, the question I had in my mind was, why is there this seeming aloofness between our two countries after we gained our independence? And to flash forward to your earlier anecdote about your experience in New York, I'm not sure if I would speak for every Filipino, but I don't think we view Spain or the Spanish people as our colonizers. You are our long-lost siblings. It's as if at one point in our family's history, we had this rupture, and then we decided to have not anything to do with each other anymore. But I'm glad to say that over the years, since we gained our independence, the Philippines has grown up to be a very modern, a very vibrant economy, and with its people all over the world, helping other economies develop their own economies. So I think it's quite, the reason I prefaced my remarks by saying that there's this mutual aloofness, because amongst European tourists, Spanish tourists are only number 9, among all the tourists that visit the Philippines, people coming from Spain is only number 19. So you're not even in the top 10, right? So there are probably more Scandinavians, more Italians, more French, more Germans than there are Spanish tourists in the Philippines. And the opposite is also true. Most Filipinos who want to visit Europe would rather think of going to Paris first, London, and not to Madrid, you know? But I'm glad to report that this is slowly changing. I've been in the embassy since April last year, and we've seen a lot of young people from Spain getting visas. Although you are supposed to be able to go to our country visa-free for up to 30 days, most Spanish people look at the Philippines and see immediately that they need more than 30 days. So they apply for a visa beforehand. And so I would like to congratulate Stephanie for using your art to spark this conversation between our two countries. And hopefully this event will eventually boil over into more future events like this for greater cultural exchange and interaction and conversations between ourselves and the Spanish people. Maraming salamat po. Mabuhay po tayo.
Thank you.
Let us become the top number one visitors of the Philippines. Please.
Anyone else?
Oh, there's a question there.
Thank you again for the work. And as the host mentioned earlier, I thought the work really explains itself when you experience it. However, I wanted to know how you came to the title of the work. Could you explain a little bit about that?
Sure. Good question. Thank you, Adam. Yeah, there's this song that was circulating in my head called Search for Life. And even before I started making the work, I would just listen to the song on repeat because it reminded me of like lyrics that a butterfly would write or like the story of a butterfly, because the Search for Life song is about looking at things from high up and seeing sand and waves and dunes and forgetting about things and becoming other things, and talks a lot about nature, and I don't know, it just reminded me of how a butterfly would write a song. So I actually, the song is included in the film as the last song that the florist sings. Yeah, you can hear it in the film called Search for Life.
Stay till the end of the film.
It's only 20 minutes. You can stay for the whole thing. Anyone else? I think that's it.
If there is no more questions, I would like to end by thanking both the team of TBA21 and the team of the Museo Nacional Thyssen for making this possible. As you know, these are commissions. It means that we don't know what it is till this morning, more or less. So we work on it in an almost butterfly way, migrating towards the work and trying to find ways of communicating and producing something that we have joy and you have joy with, and we both learn something. So this would not be possible without those that sustain the work, have the patience, and actually suspend questions like, what is the work about all the time? So those amazing professionals, thank you so, so much. And the work is gonna be on view till May 26. And please, if questions, we are here to help. And thank you very much. Enjoy the work.